So we've got client A, we'll call her Jane. Jane came to us in March and knee pain, recovering from knee surgery that was done over 2 years ago. And what we do with an onboarding protocol, our onboarding protocol for people, especially the ones in pain, we like for them to come in for an orientation. We run them through an assessment. We explain our services. And then I introduce one or two exercises. And then I let them go. That gives me an idea of who I'm dealing with. Am I dealing with someone who takes cues well? Am I dealing with someone who has a lot of maladaptive beliefs? Am I dealing with someone who is very turned off by flexion? Because that is, I mean, that's huge for us because we teach a lot of tucking and exhaling. And if someone has a background of flexing is bad, extension is good, then we also have to work around that. And it gives me an idea of how, if does a person flare up, how do they act towards a flare up? So all these things have a huge influence on how we deal with this person, how we program with this person. So Jane flared up, knee hurt a ton the next day, calls me, freaking out, asking if she needed to go see her doctor again, who she had just seen, saying everything was fine, get another scan. It's like her mind went to like worst case scenario. And I calmed her down. And I said something along the lines of, you know, like the cool thing is that your body usually starts producing pain way before there's anything to worry about. Yesterday, we did go through some new moves that your body was not used to. So why don't you wait until tomorrow? That's when we have our next session planned out and we'll see how you feel. And then sure enough, next day, she felt fine. She came in and then I walked her through what the plan was going to be. So that's Jane. Then I'm going to talk about Carol. So Carol came to us and not necessarily a lot of pain, but had never trained before, ever, had never exercised before. And what I ran her through, more than one thing. I ran her through a couple breathing exercises, did some half kneeling, an assisted squat. It was about 5-6 exercises. And she came in the next day, that had flared her up. She was in pain for like 3 or 4 days. So then I brought it down a notch. We did less exercises. And then again, pain again for multiple days, for like 4 or 5 days. We don't really want our clients to flare up that much, and we do try to de-threaten flare-ups. So then I broke it down even more for her, and again, same thing. So how do I deal with this person? How do I deal with people like Jane and people who like Carol, who seem like they can't do anything? Not even a handful of exercises. A lot of coaches would get scared of that and think, okay, maybe this person needs to be referred out. If you have a physical therapist that has a better skill set than you at getting people moving better, progressing through the training floor, by all means, refer that person to that physical therapist and that professional, or maybe it's another coach. But that doesn't mean that you still can't keep them. It doesn't mean it's an either or thing, like just because a referral is warranted because of the lack of your skill set, doesn't mean that that person can't stay with you. And today what I'm gonna go through is the stuff that you can do with that person, and it's really going to help them out. And just because it seems like they can't do anything that day or in that time, doesn't mean that they'll always be this way. Because before I take you through our protocol, let me tell you what Jane and Carol are doing today. Jane, who flared up after that one session with one exercise, who wanted to go to the doctor and get scans on her knee after feeling a knee pain, she is now full on warm up. She has some 90-90 rock back breathing, and then she has her dynamic warm up, which is not too dynamic, but we're getting there. Kettlebell arm bars, glute bridges, dead bugs, half kneeling exercises, and an assisted barbell squat hold where she's holding onto a barbell, just doing 3 to 5 breaths, like an iso squat hold. Then she has split stance med ball chest press against the wall. She's doing incline kettlebell deadlifts, shoulder pressing, bridging, and then she's doing weighted squats to a box and then a split stance landmine press and quadruped tucking. She's come a really long way. And just this morning, she emailed us and said that she's loving her new program, that she woke up today feeling really good. This is someone who couldn't even do one exercise in March right before I left for Costa Rica. She said, I feel amazing today. I think the new exercises are really working. In fact, for the first time ever, my knee did not hurt after playing tennis. Thank you so much. Wow. I could have gotten rid of her. I could have like, okay, you can't even do one exercise without hurting yourself. Like, go somewhere else. Just turning people away, one, that might not help them at all. She'd already been through physical therapy. Unless she goes to someone like Jordan here in Lexington, like she probably would have never progressed through a strength training program. She would have stayed where she was at, thinking of herself as this person who's not capable of doing much physical activity. Now let's go to Carol. Carol, who I had to keep bringing it back. And it got to the point with Carol's the session that didn't flare her up, I broke 90-90 down into three activities. We did five tucks in the 90-90 position, where she was just tucking her hips. And then she would do five exhales without doing anything with her hips, without doing anything with her arms. And then she would do five exhales with one arm, and then five exhales with the other arm. And then in the 90-90 position, she would do five knee extensions. So she would just extend her knee, and then the other one, and then the other one, and that crushed her quads. And that was her workout. So I broke down the 90-90 exercise into 3 to 4 different activities, and she ran through those like 4 or 5 times, and those were her first few sessions. Now, warm up, she's doing rock back 90-90, assisted ramp squat hold. She's doing arm bar, single leg glute bridges, half kneeling kettlebell chops, down dog hold, where she's holding the top position of downward dog, reverse lunge, cross connect. That's just her warm up. And then workout A, she's doing one arm kettlebell cleans, ball slams, kettlebell deadlifts, and then her training session, strength training component, kettlebell deadlifts, dumbbell press, split squats, single arm rows, and then she did an echo bike finisher. This person that I had to break down 90-90 into 3 to 4 different activities is now lifting just like any regular person, but I met them where they were at. And this is what we did. When you're dealing with these people, you have to take a few things into consideration that could be influencing their perception of themselves and their inability to do anything without flaring up. So the first one is their belief of themselves and how they perceive themselves. Because if someone sees themselves as someone who's not capable of much physical activity, if in the past they've flared up by just doing simple things like walking is a very low level activity. So if you go anything beyond walking, like a squat where your quads are shaking a little bit, then that can really screw the person up into thinking that if walking flares me up, therefore something beyond walking is definitely going to flare me up. And that can feed into someone's chances of having a flare up, even though they did nothing wrong in the training floor. So someone's beliefs can really prevent people from progressing and doing these things with confidence. And confidence is huge with people in persistent pain, them feeling confident in their own body. So yes, you could have the pain talk. You could talk about maladaptive beliefs. You can show them facts. Look, your SI joint does not go out of place. Here's all the facts. And you can have the pain doesn't equal damage. You could have all those talks. But some beliefs are so ingrained that as a coach, you have no option but to meet the beliefs where they're at and then trick them out of it. And this is where finding 1 to 8 activities that they feel really good about is step number one. In order to do this correctly though, you have to have a training model that's very consistent, because we're tricking their brain and their mind, who thinks they're fragile. Look, if we can get you to do these exercises on the ground that are very safe, and I don't care how long it takes you to get comfortable with 90-90, like that one client, it took us a few weeks. Let's get you feeling this one exercise and get you to feel really good about it, and then slowly progress from there. When you have a consistent training model, that means the low level activities that you get this person to feel really safe with, the cues, the references, the feeling, the muscles working in those positions are the same positions, cues, feelings, that you do when you try to progress them on the training floor to do things like split squats and squatting with weight and doing any upper body lifts, because it's consistent. It's the same cues, it's the same positions, and if you got them to feel comfortable with this, then you can get them here if your training model is consistent and it has these consistent standards of how movement should look and how it should be felt and how it should be cued within your staff. Unfortunately, I can't teach that online, but September 30th at Hype in New York City, Michelle Bolin and I have a seminar that talks about a consistent training model so you can be successful with these people. And that's like one out of like the 10 reasons why it would behoove you and your staff to have a consistent training model. Do you all follow the same standards? Does the same 90-90 standard look the same as the quadruped standard and then the squat standard? Because if it does, you can now train these people, because you're tricking their beliefs into thinking that they're not capable of much, but you just showed them they were. You did 90-90, now look at my body here, it looks the same. Oh, it does look the same. Oh, wow, I do feel the same glutes. Oh, it's the same abs. Now, even though they thought they were fragile, you tricked them out of that state because you gave them consistency. So you find one or eight activities that they feel really good about, and that's your base. From there, once you have your base, that's when you can start exploring new things, introduce a new movement, introduce a new lift. And if they flare up, you can always go back to this. So at least I now have a safe spot of, okay, at least now I can go back to this and I know for sure that I'm capable of doing this. Because if you don't find this, then they're gonna start losing confidence in you of, look, Lucy can't even find one thing that doesn't hurt me. So I'm gonna go somewhere else or just not train because my body's not capable, because that's what they think. So find the base, so you can always go back to it. They always feel good about it. And then you can start exploring and you always have this to fall back to. Number two, don't rush. Like a screw novelty. Understand that these people's goals and these people's fears are different than yours. They're not you. So these people don't really care about when you're gonna introduce all these fancy new equipments of like, what's the Zercher squat or what's this like spider bar thing or the kettlebells or the weight or the novelty or the load. Like they're not waiting for that. That's not what their goals are right now in the beginning. You know what they want? They just wanna be able to move and not feel punished the next day. They wanna be able to find a physical activity that can keep them active and not dig the hole deeper with them and feel pain. They wanna find something that they can do that doesn't take them back to the horrible pain that they had to deal with for 5 to 10 years that kept them in bed after going to work, so they lost everything. Like, don't rush with these people. They're not in a rush. So don't sit there and think that, oh, I need to introduce new things and progress them, because they probably don't care about novelty. So really understand what their fears and their goals are, because they're not the same as another person who's a fat loss client who has a lifting background. Not the same. So don't treat them the same. And then I added a bonus step here because I just didn't have space. Act normal. The client who I had to keep pulling back and keep dissecting, that's like one exercise, my demeanor was like, totally normal. Oh, okay, well, you felt pain, that's cool, we'll try something else. We'll just keep bringing it back and we'll just keep doing it until we find something that doesn't bother you. Or the client who called me with her knee pain and thinking she had to go get another MRI, my demeanor didn't change. It was like it happens all of the time. Versus my client coming into the gym for the third time saying I was in pain all over again and me freaking out like, oh, okay, I'm sorry. All right, so that hurt, so we don't want that. So act normal, act like you deal with it all the time. Don't make them feel like they're alone or they're the only ones that have to go through this or singled out that they can't do much. I mean, they already feel down about themselves. They already feel like they're not capable of much and they're probably already embarrassed about that. So act normal, and I should add, give them praise for doing things well. And I think that's another reason why we're so successful with these people, because I will praise the shit out of them for them tucking correctly. And I will even call the other coach to come by and say, oh, look how amazing Jane's tucking is from last week. So we give them praise, and then we act normal that wherever they are in their journey right now is totally fine and they shouldn't feel bad about it. So that was a bonus step. Other thing that you can do. So you find 1 or 8 activities. Okay, that's great. I mean, that's better for them than going home and not doing anything. You can also add some cardio. So if your gym has a bike or a treadmill, that is perfect. Start with 5 minutes, try to get to 30 minutes. So even if this person can do 2 exercises, fine. Go through those 2 exercises 3 to 4 times through, and then hop on the bike for 5 minutes. And see how they handle that. And the next day, hop on the bike for 15 minutes and see how they handle that, and try to work up to something. The other thing too is, how much are these people moving? If you want someone to recover from your workouts and they're taking like 1,000 to 2,000 steps a day, that might be a contributor to why they're not able to handle such low level activities. So getting these people moving more will help them handle more stuff in the gym. And then number 4, understand that some of the reasons why this person can't progress go beyond your skill set and beyond your control. So understanding that pain is influenced by many different factors, and it's not just structure, it's not just movement, it's not just damage. Understand that it could be other things that are beyond your control or your skill set. So that doesn't mean you still can't work with them. So even though someone maybe needs to go see a trauma expert, or they need to go see a counselor, or they need to go see a life coach, or they need to go see a dentist because they have sleep apnea, or because they, I don't know, anything. There's so many things that influence pain. Just because it's beyond your control and beyond your skill set does not mean that you still can't do these things. So even if a referral is warranted with these people, you can still train them. Find 1 or 8 activities that they can do that don't flare them up. You'll be more successful with that if it's consistent with the rest of your training model and the rest of the exercises on the training floor. Come to my seminar. Don't rush. Understand what their goals are, what their limitations are, what their fears are, and take that in consideration, and understand that they probably don't care about novelty. They would probably be happy with the same 10 exercises for months. And of course, you don't want to do that. You do want to progress them, but understand that that's where they're at. So meet them where they're at. Work on cardio, get them moving, 5-30 minutes on the bike, treadmill, get them 10,000 steps, get them moving outside of the gym, because that is huge. And then understand things go beyond your skill set, but even if that's the case, that does not mean you still can't work with these people and like completely change their lives. Like, to me, in my eyes, what they're doing now, amazing. The fact that they weren't able to do anything before, and it had nothing to do with how damaged they were or dysfunctional, none of that. We just had to meet them where they were at. So no client left behind, even these people. And if you really suck at coaching movement, or you're not good at coaching movement, then maybe that's something that you need to work on, or find a mentor in your area, a good physical therapist that is good at coaching movement, and learn from them. Because if you get really good at coaching people through movement that feels good, where they don't necessarily feel their pain, you're now teaching them to move and be confident in their body, and making them realize like, wow, I can move my body and not feel like shit like I have for the last 5-10 years. So that is all I have. Please work with these people, because they need fitness. They desperately need it. They just need to be met where they're at.